Welcome to all of you. We are going to talk about data structures. Data structures is one very important concept in computer science, and as you all know, all programs and all applications use data structures as its fundamental concept. So, understanding of data structures is a very important methodology that you have to follow when you study computer science. So, what is data structures? Data structures is a systematic way of manipulating data. Data structures structures data, usually more than one piece of data, and we have to provide some legal operations on the data, and the data can also be joined together, that is, it can be a collection. Basically, data structure talks about two aspects. One aspect is the data organization and the other is the manipulating of data. In fact, the manipulation of data, how we want to manipulate the data and how we want to organize the data, results in the different data structures that we are going to talk about. Okay. So, all of you or some of you have done computer programming, and there you have used programming languages, and there are some data types that are called primitive data types. For example, and this holds a single piece of data in Java or maybe in C, most programming languages have built-in data types called int, which stands for integer, long, which stands for long integer, char, which stands for character, boolean, which stands for boolean values. And there are some legal operations which is stressed for these built-in data types, like for example, for integer you have plus, minus, multiplication and division. Nowadays, because of the coming up of object-oriented programming languages, abstract data types have gained a lot of importance. So, when we talk about data types, we also talk about abstract data types. Abstract data type is like a black box in which you have a data type along with its operation, and the properties are specified, and the user of the abstract data type does not have to know what particular implementation is used for implementing that particular data type. So, when we look from data to data structures, actually, the machine stores only binary data, so that is what you can see on top of the figure. And then you have primitive data types, for example, 23, which is a integer, 3.1415, which is a decimal, and A, which is a character. And then you have some basic data structures like arrays and structures, which are used to store these data types. And then you have a high level data structures like stack, queue, and list. Stack, queue, and list are data structures that are defined so that you can do particular operations on these type of data structures. We talk about data to data structures. So, actually, as you all know, data is stored in the machine in the form of binary bits, and that is what is called machine level data storage. And then we have primitive data types that are provided by most programming languages like integers, floating point like 3.145, and characters like A. Then you have some basic data structures that are also provided in programming languages like arrays and structures. In addition to this, we have high level data structures which are special type of lists and structures like stack, queue, and list. So, when you talk about data structures, there are two types of data structures, linear data structures and non-linear data structures. In the linear data structures, the most common is the array. This is a fixed size data structure, and then you have linked list, which is a variable size data structure, which we will be discussing again in detail as we go along. Then you have stack. Stack is a very common data structure. Its main thing is it is a restricted form of list where you add and delete elements from only one point at the top of the stack. Then you have queue. You have seen queues in many places where people come and stand at the end of the queue which is called the rear of the queue, and our people are taken away from the queue from the front. So, that is why we call adding to the back and removing from the front. So, this is called as priority queue, where you have add anywhere and you can remove with the highest priority. There are other types of important data structures which is very necessary for many applications of computer science, and one such is the hash table. The hash table is commonly used for compilers, storing of variable names for compilers and so on. So hash tables are unordered lists which use a hash function to insert and delete, and then you have a tree. A tree is a very important data structure. It is unlike most other data structures since it is a non-linear data structure and because it has a branching structure. Then a graph is a more linear type of data structure than the tree, where a tree has no loops. A graph has less stringent conditions and there can be loops in a graph. Now we have seen some data structures. When we talk about data structures, we also you remember that I talked to you about data organization. In addition to data organization, what manipulations you can do with these data types or data structures is a very important concept. So let's look at some of the operations you normally do on data structures. One is you have to create an empty data structure or create an empty list. Then you have to determine whether the list is given a list, you have to determine whether it is empty or not. And you sometimes you need to know the number of items in a list also. And then you need to add an item. Given the position in the list, you want to add an item. That's a typical operation. Or remove an item from a given position in the list, or remove all items from the list. Now, actually, what are the operations you do, how often you do, depends on the application. Some applications you just do. You just look at only addition deletion. Certain operation, certain applications you do, you have to find out whether the list is empty and such things. So the operations and the combination of operation depends on the particular application that you want your data structures to have. Another important operation of a data structure is to get an item from a given position in the list. And accessing of elements in a list is a very important operation, and so is searching and sorting. If you take any application, for example, counseling that you have in Anna University and certain other applications, sorting of the ranks and searching for a particular student and things in a list is a very important operation, and mostly all these occur very frequently. Searching and sorting is very frequently used operations of data structures. Sometimes you need to get the capacity of the list, what is the total count of the elements in the list, and sometimes you need to modify, that is you need to update, delete or insert elements in the list. Generally you say that for most applications this type of modification is not as common as accession. Now if you look at data structures, you can also think of a matrix as a data structure, a linked list as a data structure, a tree as a data structure and a network as a data structure. How this is implemented and how this is represented is what we are going to look at as we go along. So first we will go to the simplest of the data structure, which is a list. So this is a fundamental data structure in computer science, and this processing is considered as one of the most important data structure, and has been the inspiration for a particular type of programming language called Lisp. And the list of integers is one of the most widely used kind of list, and there can be also collection and set instances. Example of lists are integer list, for example, 0 plus 1 minus 1 plus 2 minus 2 plus 3 minus. This is an example of an integer list. You can also have a list of days of the week, which is given there. And sometimes it's not necessary that all the elements of the list need be of the same type, or they need to be related. For example, we have given apple chair 2, 5.2, red, green, jack. There is no connection between the elements of the list, but still that is also a list, a valid list. Now, when you talk about lists, there are many ways in which you can classify lists, but the most important classification is unordered lists and ordered lists. Unordered list means the elements in the list are not in any particular order or sorted order. It could be sorted alphabetically or numerically, but either way, in unordered lists, they are not sorted. Ordered lists, it's similar to alphabetic lists of employee names, for example, or the rank of students in an exam and so on, are the typical example of ordered lists. These order lists, they keep the items in a specific order, and so most manipulations that you do on these lists depends on those the ordered of the list. Whenever an item is added to the list, it has to be placed in the correct order, And similarly, when you remove an element from the list, the rest of the elements still have to remain in sorted order. So this is an example of a linear list. It's a sequence of elements. There is something called a first element and there is something called a last element. And if you take each and every element, it has a previous element and a next element. And obviously, there is no element before the first element and there is no element after the last element. So for example, you can represent a list. It could be linear list or order list of the form E0, E1, E2 to EN minus 1. And you are assuming that N is finite. And the size of the list is obviously N, 0 to N minus 1, so N. And here if you look, E0 is the front or the 0th element of the list. EN minus 1 is the last element. And EI always precedes plus 1 or E plus 1 succeeds EI. So there is a definite relationship between the elements of the list, especially in the case of order lists. So for example, linear list examples are students in some particular course. So Jack, Jill, Abby, Henry, Mary, Judy, please note that this is not an order list. And then you have exams in this particular computer science, exam 1, exam 2, exam final or exam 3 also you can have, days of a week, months, all these are example of linear lists. Now we are going to go more in detail to list operations. So first is create an empty list. We are going to look at each of these operations in detail as we go along. So create an empty list, determine whether a list is empty, get an item at a given position in the list, that is normally called as retrieval, determine the number of items in a list, that is count the number of items in a list, then given an element, find the index of that element, then traverse the element. You want to find all the elements in the list, then add an item at a given position, remove an item from a given position, remove all items. You can think of many such operations depending on your application, but these which we have discussed are some of the very common operations that you do on any list. So first let us look at, as we have seen, this is create an empty list. So first let us look at create. The description is it creates a new empty list and the inputs are either it can be no inputs or it can give, okay, I want to create an integer list means the type of the elements in the list are integers, or if I want to create a character list, it can be character. And the output is only an empty list, so no specific output is given out. So if you look at this, result is a new empty list is created. What you haven't specified the size, you may have to specify the type and you may want to specify something else. So that is about create a list. Now is empty is you want to find out whether a list is empty or not. So it is the function of this is to find out if a list is empty. So the inputs is obviously the list, output it's a boolean output, it gives true if the list is empty and it gives false if the list is not empty. And the result is after this operation the list still remains unchanged. Next is an important operation of a linear list is the get an index. So get an element. So the input is get an element which has a specific index. So if you look at this, you have L is equal to A, B, C, D, E. This is an example list. So if you get 0, remember that the list is stored from 0 to N minus 1. So when you say get 0, you get A. When you say get 2, you get C and so on. And if you give indexes that are not valid like minus 1, you will get an error. And 9, though it is a valid integer, it is not an index of the list. The maximum value of the index of the list is E0 to E4 here. So that gives an error. So the description is, the idea is given an index, you want to get the item from the list. So the input is the index, the item to be got from that index. Output is it returns the item at the specific index and it will throw an exception if the index is not valid. But please note here also that the list remains unchanged. Next is retrieval. Retrieval means which we have just discussed. So suppose I give this and I want to retrieve the element called dog. Okay, I do not know, for example, I have given the index as 1, it will retrieve dog for me, but please note the list at the top and the list at the bottom do not change, I mean they are the same. Only thing is from that particular index I am taking out the data element and showing it to the user. Next is an important operation is size and index of. Size means it just determines the list size. For example, if it is given A, B, C, D, E, the size of the list is 5. Next important one is index of the element. Here, unlike the previous one, when we are given the index and try to get an element, here we are given an element and try to get the index for that element. So, for example, given the list A, B, C, D, E, the index of D is equal to 2, the index of A is equal to 0, the index of Z is minus 1 because Z is not there, the index of D, the index of D is actually here 3. Next is traverse. Traverse is find all go into the list and get out the elements in that particular order. So, when you say get first, you are given list as input, it returns the first element of the list. When you say get next list, it returns the next element in the list if it exists. And both function will return null if there is no element at all. So, calling of this get next in a loop will get you all the elements in the list. Next important operation is an insert. So, what we have seen up to now, let us look at all the operations. What all we have seen is get index, find out it is empty, create a list and then retrieve an element and so on. All this did not change the elements, but from now on what we are seeing changes the element. So, linear list operation, first one is insert. So, you are adding, you are given an index and an element and adding an element into the array. So, function adds an item to the list and the precondition is the list has to exist. The list should not be full. I will give a more explanation about this full as we go along. And if the, we are assuming that no duplicates are allowed. So, if the item is already in the list, we are not allowing an insertion. And the post condition is after the insertion operation, the item will be in the list. So, for example, suppose you have A, B, C, D, E, F, G as a list and if you are given add 0, H, 0 is the index to which you want to add and H is the element to be added, then you will, this will be the result. L is equal to H, A, B, C, D, E, F, G. Please note that the index of A, B, C, D, E, F, G has increased by 1. Before the add operation, the index of A was 0. After the add operation, the index of A is 1. Similarly, if you, that is when you want to add to the front of the list. Suppose you wanted to add in the second position, 0, 1, 2. So, here add 2 comma H. Now, the index of A and B will not change, but the index of C, D, E, F, G will change or increase by 1. That means the complete elements after the insertion operation have been shifted or moved by one place. Now, suppose you give add 10 comma H where 10 does not exist in the element, that is the number of elements is less than 10, then you will get an error. And if you give minus 6 H also, you will get an error. So, let us look at the insertion operation. So, I want to insert an element which is called 25 and I want to insert it at the second position. So, what happens is the initial list is having 10, 20, 30 and the data I want to add is 25 and it has been told to me that I want to add it after 20. So, after the insertion operation I get 10, 20, 25 and 30. So, now 25 has been added to the list and you get a new list. Next is, so that is an addition operation. Next is remove and you are from a list and you are given the index. So, remove an element from a list, the input is the index, that is the item which you want to remove and the index of that item. And then if the you give an index out of range, it will throw an error. Now, if the index is valid, the item has to be removed and all items in the list will have moved one position or decreased by one position. We will see the example. The previous one we saw was about removal. Next is delete. Remove and return element with given index. So, remove an element, deletes the element whose key matches the item's key. So, list here there are some preconditions for delete. First you have to have a list and the key member of item has been initialized and we are assuming again there are no duplicates. So, if you find an item which you which element which you want to, you will have find only one. So, the item's key will be matched to only one element. The post condition for delete is no element in list has a key matching items key. So, suppose you have A, B, C, D, E, F, G and it is given remove 2, that is the element 0, please remember our index starts with 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So, remove 2 means you have to it will return C and the list will change now to A, B, D, E, F, G and now what has happened is D, E, F, G all the indexes of D, E, F, G elements has decreased by 1. So, if you take the example of this particular list, blue, green, red and yellow and you want to delete an element with called red, then what will happen after the deletion operation, the list becomes blue, green, yellow only and the output is given out as red, which means that red has been deleted. So another operation that we have spoken about is remove all. All the elements of the list have to be removed. So removes all elements from the list. Input is none, output is none, and but after you finish the operation, the list comes out to be empty. Examples of this such type of list is a phone book, the data of phone records. Normally the operation, now we are looking at the example with what type of operations you want to do on the list. So for example, you add to an empty list, remove an entry, look up someone's phone number by name. So name will be given, you will have to search for that particular name and find the phone number, and you want to find a list of all the phone numbers. So view one entry at a time, this is like traversal, and get the number of entries is the count. So add, remove, retrieve, traverse and get the number of items. And here the details are that normally in a phone book the numbers will be stored in alphabetic order. Another is shopping list, to do list, schedule, list of people in a class. You can have umpteen number of lists, and normally they are in some order. And normally when you talk about items in a list, they are of the same type, that is they will be either integers or they will be names of people or they will be name and phone number and so on. And the variations of a list include whether what order you have. You can have for the same list, you can have alphabetic order, you can also have numerical order. And what are the type of elements in the list and what are the common operations you want to do. Depending on the application, the operations you want to do will change. What can we do with a linear list? We can delete an element, we can insert an element, we can find an element, we can traverse a list and so on. And you can sort by numerically, alphabetically, you can do any type of sorting. So when you look at lists and specifically linear lists, you can think of two types of the following classification, where you have general and restricted lists. General lists can be unordered and ordered, and restricted lists can be FIFO. We will talk about this FIFO as we go along, that is a queue, and LIFO, again we will talk about this in detail, which is the stack. Now up to now we have not looked at implementation at all, we have just looked at what is the list and how the list can be, how does the list look like. It can be a list of numbers, it can be a list of names, it can be a list of telephone numbers and so on. And we have looked at what are the operations you can do. We have tried to list all the operations that any application of which uses list would want. But then if you want to actually represent this in a computer, you have to implement it using some particular method of implementation. So there are different types in which list can be implemented. One is arrays, one is linked list, and we also can implement a list using doubly linked list. Now we will be talking only about array and linked list as we go along. So array, now how to choose the implementation of whether we want to do an array implementation or list implementation depends upon the operations you want to do with the list and nothing else. And what operations you want to do with the list depends on the application of the list. Okay. So you have to decide whether you want an array implementation or a linked list implementation depending upon the applications, and the application will decide on what operations, the operation will decide on the implementation. So we are first going to look at the array array implementation. Before we go look into how to do the array implementation, let us look at what type of operations on list is made easier by the array implementation. So search is easy if you use arrays, traversal is easy if you use arrays. Insertion and deletion, it is not that you cannot do insertion and deletion, it is not efficient to do insertion and deletion. If it is a fairly common operation in your application, it is better to avoid array implementation. And it is hard to, one of the major problems of array implementation is before you start an implementation, you do not know, or an application will not know how much of storage you want to give for the array. Because for an array, before you start an implementation, you have to say, okay, 100. I want to allocate 100 locations for this particular implementation of the list. But the problem is the application, can you guess it? If you put too large a number, what will happen? You are wasting memory space. If you put too less, then you will get a listful condition quite often. So this is the problem of using arrays. But array has its own advantages, because if the list which is implemented using the array is used mainly for searching and for traversal, then the array implementation of a list is the best. You can also implement list using linked list. Now, there is a slight confusion among the students on what is a list and what is a linked list. Actually, list is nothing but a list of names, a list of numbers and so on, and has nothing to do with implementation. A list can be implemented using different data structures. You can implement a list using arrays, you can implement a list using linked list and so on. Linked list data structure is used for implementation. Please make out the difference. List is a data structure which you have to implement using either arrays or linked list. So, linked list is not used only for representing list. Linked list can be used for implementing queues, stacks, trees and so on. So, this is the difference between list and linked list. I want to make this clear as we go along. In this lecture, we have seen the importance of data structures. We have seen some operations on data structures. Then we have taken a simple data structure, the list, and seen certain typical operations that you can do on list. Let us answer some simple questions. Let us assume that int stands for integer in programming languages. What is it? Is it an abstract data type, simple data type, built-in data type, or complex data structure? It is actually a built-in data type that is provided by the programming language itself. Arrays is a good implementation of lists for which operation? Insertion, deletion or searching. It is a good operation for searching. Thank you.